The following program is a special presentation of Cleveland Community College.
Hello, Cleveland County, and welcome to the studios of C19 here on the campus of Cleveland Community College in Shelby. We thank you for joining us. As always, we try to take a perspective of world events and how it's impacting us here in Cleveland County. And with the events in Europe unfolding right now, we have assembled a panel of experts to address this issue for us, just specifically here. For what seems like uncounted days, weeks, and months, we've heard wars and rumors of wars about the Ukraine and the Soviet, you know, the former Soviet Union, and Russia, and how the invasion was imminent. On February the 24th, it went from rumors and it to actual a land event. By some, it's been characterized as the largest conventional military strike in Europe since World War II. And so the countless civilian military deaths have been accounted for, or at least reported. The exact numbers, have no idea to know at this point in time. But on day eight, we'd like to kind of look back and begin to talk about what is the event as it is unfolding now, but what are the larger ramifications? Because I know in my own personal life, I've had several people look and say, okay, so what? Well, I think there is a so what. I think it's relevant to us here. It's a humanitarian disaster, but it may even be more than that. So with us today, we've got a number of experts. If I could, I'll start off and let everybody introduce yourself. David, I'll start with you. David Eskridge. Hey,
my name is David Eskridge. I am an economics instructor here at Cleveland.
Well, that's good. So we want to talk about how this, the ramifications for Cleveland County, and how this can impact us as well. A longtime friend of mine, Dr. Star Camper. Let's you go ahead. And what's your background?
My background is I have a master's and a PhD in women's history, but my secondary study is Soviet history, Russian history, particularly during the Soviet era, so I'm a little bit late, but still looking at Soviet history.
Look, you've gotten your whole life getting ready for today. Thank you so much for that. Just to my immediate left, we've got Walter Sperling, but some of you know him as Scott, but tell me about your background.
Currently, I'm an electronics instructor here at Cleveland Community College. I did 26 years in the Army. Part of that I did in Ukraine, in Donetsk, Ukraine, and Kiev. Also was in Kurchatov, Kazakhstan for a while. So I worked with a little bit of the Russian Army here and there.
So you're familiar with the area, and you pronounce all the names really well, much better than I will do, I promise. And another long-term friend of mine, Dennis Bailey, and he's got a wealth of information to share as well.
I'm a retired Air Force Master Sergeant. I was an intelligence analyst for about 16 and a half years of my career, retired back in 2000. So most of my time in intelligence regarding Russia was mostly Soviet Union.
Okay.
The world hasn't changed so much that people are different. The things are still happening the way they happen because people don't change.
Well, and I think I have to put this in perspective. For many of us in this in the circle, or some of you watching, those baby boomers, our parents were getting us ready for a conflict with the Soviet Union by having us prepare for a thermonuclear explosion by hiding under a wooden desk.
Yep.
So that's we have to put that. But things, the uncertainty of our childhood has diminished, but yet there's still uncertainty. Let's talk about when this actually started, because this did not start on the 24th. This has been a land of turmoil for a long time, has it not?
Absolutely. The Ukrainians and Russians have a very common history with the Slavic people, and both of them under Kiev and Rus. Kiev was actually the capital thousands of years back, I guess it'd be hundreds of years back. So they have a common history, or a common ethnic history there. And then, of course, once Stalin or Lenin, and then Stalin took over and created the Soviet Republic there. You had all those mini states a part of it. And as I've been looking at this, I'm really have been thinking back to post-World War II with Stalin. He was very nervous about having his borders pro-democratic. And so he worked very hard creating the Warsaw Pact in Eastern Europe to be communist so that he felt secure. He said that twice during his lifetime he had been invaded by supposed democracies. And I think of this as Putin, because he talks a lot about NATO and how it is slowly creeping up on him. The Ukraine being the most current one, in the process of becoming part of NATO. They're not, and President Biden says it'll be a little bit. But to Putin, that could happen any time. And once you have NATO against you, and that's the way I think Putin feels, and I'm not justifying what he did, but I think it's a sense of fear. He is scared of what's on his border. He has Belarus and Moldova, Georgia to an extent, I guess. But everything else there, it's just merging against what he thinks he thinks.
And I've seen some national reports that kind of indicate he would like to roll back to a time of that former Soviet Union,
yes,
and capture what that looked like, what that landmass looked like at the end of the Cold War, or change what happened since the Cold War and reestablish some of that.
Absolutely. If he were to take Ukraine, I mean, Ukraine is bordered. You have Poland there. That was a former Warsaw Pact. And then you have Belarus, which is already pro-Russian. You have Slovakia. Hungary is there. Romania is there. And those are all past pro-Russian countries, whether they wanted to be or not, they were.
Yeah.
And I mean, I think he does look toward that, trying to create that power, because he doesn't have that power anymore. I mean, the days of the great Soviet Union are not current.
Yeah, absolutely. And I guess that's probably an aspect of it as well. A democracy that was looks at least flourishing from compared to what goes on maybe in Russia. From an economic standpoint, David, I think you look at it, their country, Russia, as compared to having that next door neighbor with all the new shiny cars in their yard and nice things happening, and it's a threat perhaps to him?
Well, when we look at trade agreements, just like we have with Mexico or Canada, if Canada can produce things cheaper for us, then that's a benefit to everybody here that's buying it, because our money goes further. So trade agreements are usually a good thing, and with Russia, it's no different. If they can do trade with their surrounding countries, then that's going to be a benefit. They're going to get more value for an efficiency of production.
Sure. You know, in the 21st century, it's a much smaller world, not physically, but as far as interconnectivity, we're also so much more connected than we were 100 years ago. And so I look at it and think, our global economy, one piece, the Ukraine, well, does it have a huge impact on everything, or can people in Cleveland County, this never really have an impact for them?
So when we talk about comparative advantage, the advantages that we get with doing business with other people, if they can produce it cheaper than we can, then there's a benefit to us. So with companies want to maximize profits, right?
Sure.
And so and people try to maximize their satisfaction and utility. Economics is a behavioral science. With any sort of conflict that we have going on right now, that creates shocks to supply. Your company is going to say, we want to make 50 million products this year, and that's our goal. And so they staff everything, people, businesses, storefronts. They budget and schedule everything to be as efficient as they can. And if they were, did I say 5 million? Whatever that magic number is that they planned for, if demand is less than that, or resource prices explode because of prices, then that changes how they do things, and they're no longer as productive and efficient as they were. And another way to say that is that's inflation, because it costs them more to produce, whether it was less or more. And so whenever companies make those plans to produce, that is the most efficient way of making money. And when the Ukraine-Russian conflict kicks in, that's going to put all sorts of changes to our supply chain. And we're just coming off of a COVID, I'll say, nightmare.
Yeah.
That has business, industry, manufacturing, services, everything has been turned upside down because of COVID. And we're just now trying to to recoup from that?
Or, you know, our recovery? Supply chain. I mean, I think that's, I had read some things earlier that said suggest our supply chain would still struggle through much of this year, be into 23 before we really started to, get back. But now this event only prolongs all that.
We have a global economy. So you look at automobiles that are made in the U.S., the huge portions of those automobiles are not made in the U.S. They're made in other places.
Sure.
So even if Ukraine, and last I heard, we're getting 600,000 barrels of oil a day from Russia. And so right now, the world has shut down most of the Russian banking system, and that's not exactly true, but they have put a lot of sanctions and restrictions on it. And so the infrastructure of your country really is based on banking. So if businesses can get, funding relatively easy and relatively cheap, and that's government stability, that's government, infrastructure regulation,
sure,
that allows businesses in the U.S. to get loans so that they can put in another piece of equipment, or they can open up another storefront, or maybe even hire more people, and that helps the economy run efficiently, right?
Yeah.
So now that Russia has all these sanctions, from a global economic standpoint, everything's going to go up in cost.
Sure. Both of y'all brought up NATO, you brought up sanctions. I want to come back and talk about both of those, but I have no idea what the Ukraine's actually like, but I think one of us has actually been there, so let's talk about it. Scott, or Walter, I'll call you, but it's almost like there's another person here. I've got two of you here, whichever one you want. Scott, tell me, you've been in the area. What can you describe what the Ukraine's really like for people that have never been out of Cleveland County?
So I was there in the 90s, so sure, it's been a while. But watching on TV, the buildings and everything are the same. And the best I can describe it is when I first got there, it was like stepping back in time. All the buildings, I mean, not that anything was trashy or even looked old, but the architecture was an older style architecture. It's like going to the old Shelby courthouse. It doesn't look like the rest of the modern buildings, and so all of their buildings were that old architecture. Mm-hmm. The food was different. I enjoyed the food. I really enjoyed working with the people. They were friendly. Just a pleasure to work with. During the time I was there, I was on a team that went in and set up hospital equipment because in 94-ish, they had just come out from under Russia or the Soviet Union. And so they were getting used to their independence. And they didn't have a lot, you know, and so we were taking military surplus equipment that was being replaced. We took it over there and hooked it up in all their hospitals. And their systems are different from ours. Their hospital, where we have one great big building and everybody goes into that building for all kinds of stuff, they would have their heart hospital and their radiation hospital and their, and they would be all in different parts of town.
Okay.
I do remember one thing that was made a big impact, their sterilization. We were putting some new sterilizers in, and their old sterilizers, they would actually sterilize their surgical equipment, mm-hmm, put a cloth over it, and drive it across town to their surgical ward, you know, yeah, things like that. So it was an older way of life.
Sure.
I mean, but they've had 30 years. You know, I can't attest to what they do now. But
and I guess to my standpoint, watching this and with the idea of the rumors of this battle has been, you know, building for some time. Mm-hmm. I really thought, you know, I guess from my layman standpoint, it would be a fairly quick battle. I mean, the Russian would come in and they would overrun the Ukrainian people, but it doesn't look like it's played out that way, has it? I mean, so from that standpoint, what's your take on that, Dennis?
When you go take over a people's country or attempt to take over a people's country, armed or not, they will do their best to stop you, and they did not ever achieve their goal. Okay, we should learn that as well. They have people there that have a heart for their country. They've had 30 years of freedom, and they are not going to let anybody take it from them.
As I was saying, Afghanistan should have been a lesson for them to learn. When you try to take over a people for economic gain, you are going to have fighters in the street. The reason that Japan did not put boots on the ground in America is because they said there would be a gun behind every blade of grass, okay? Well, the Ukraine is not that, you know, that well-armed as far as its citizenry is considered, but they have the heart of freedom. When you've had 30 years of freedom, somebody trying to take it away after you've lived in what it was before. I went to the Czech Republic on a vacation when I was stationed in Germany. And, you know, we had lots of pictures and so on, and we had some visitors here that worked at KSM Castings that were from that area, right? And so they're looking at these pictures, and they're like, oh, that's just like all the other apartments, because every apartment building is the same. Your furniture is all the same. It's issued furniture. You get to go pick up, all the chairs are going to be just like these, right? Whatever. And so then when you've had choice for a while, you don't want someone making your choices for you, okay? And so, you know, the Russian empire, if you will, is a democratic socialist state in reality, okay? And so the people in America that think, oh, we want democratic socialism, well, that's what you get, is you get no choice, and you're just a cog in the wheel. And the Ukrainians are going to fight until it becomes extremely painful for them, I'm afraid. And it looks like some of their other, not necessarily from us, but from other allies, local countries, are supplying them with good technology that's allowing them to fight the good fight with Stinger missiles and other javelins and other type of missiles that are making them very competitive in the streets, I think.
It's not just equipment. It's not just equipment. Some of it's attitude.
Yeah.
The gray ghost that you've heard of.
Oh, yeah.
Okay? In every conflict, there's always that one guy. There was this, in a conflict, okay, there was this AAA site that was just, this one guy was bulletproof. He could take down our aircraft. He could hit our aircraft. And when he was successful at first, he became that larger-than-life person. And we had to take extreme measures on one site just to stop that attitude from exploding into that pride of we're stopping America.
You know, and I think I like your analogy about it's not really that much different than the United States. So we truly pride ourselves in our democracy, our freedom, and now that they've had a taste of it, I suppose it's a lot like the old country mouse and the city mouse. The country mouse isn't going back home anymore, the same as he was when he was, now that they've had a taste of that, I suppose. If Russia's successful, though, and sorry we were talking before we started, this is probably not the end result for Putin in this situation.
No, I don't think so. And to go to add to that, the Ukrainians are very nationalistic. When Russia had them, when Stalin had them, he made them Russian. You will have this Russian Orthodox Church. You will speak Russian. The Ukrainian culture was just gone. I mean, you would be dead if you had it. And for 30 years, the Ukrainians have been building back all of that history. Ukrainian is the language. They have their own Eastern Orthodox Church. It's not Russian. And like you talk about their culture and their building and choice. And the people they're interviewing, there was this older lady. She's probably my age, but she looked a little older. But she had a gun.
Everybody always looks older when they're interviewing them, don't they, Star?
she had a gun, and she was more than willing to die for her country. But more than that, she was willing to fight. And you see that over and over. They showed a married couple. I'm sure that y'all have seen it on TV.
Sure.
Just wild. But I do agree. I'm sorry to get off on that.
No.
I'm inspired by that Ukrainian spirit. If I knew how to use a gun, I might go help them. I think Zelensky said there were 16,000 foreign people that came in just today to help with the fight. But I don't believe Putin is finished. He wants to recreate that Soviet Union of the past. And if he should do that, I mean, he already has the Crimea, which I think it was about 2014 or something. That was not his, but he took it.
That's right.
He's taken two places in the Ukraine. One starts with the L and one starts with the D. Thank you, Walter. What, do you remember the Luhansk?
I don't remember the other one.
I'm impressed you got one.
In 2014.
And he's already got those.
We're going to give you a degree, too.
Yes, we should. So those have already, he's already got that. He's got Belarus, which is right there. And like I said, Moldova's right there. And to me, that would be next. But then you go down, if you go into the Asian part, you have Turkmenistan and Georgia and Azerbaijan and Armenia. And I'd hate to think, but the Baltic states are right up there. They're NATO, yeah, but they are right there. So, and they give him access to that sea.
And this
there.
Is a more southern, so I suppose the climate is a little better than main Russia. Is that
yeah,
right?
Like the Crimea is like Hilton Head or something.
Yeah, I mean, it's still cool. I would
it's
guess
not like Siberia. Cooler,
I guess,
right?
Yeah. No, no. I would say it's similar. I can't remember, but while I was there, it seems like it was similar to Virginia. Maybe it wasn't not bad weather. Okay. You know,
yeah. I just curious about
in history. It's been called the breadbasket.
Yeah.
When it was the Soviet Union, the Ukraine was the breadbasket.
In their flag, doesn't their flag have like amber waves? I mean, amber waves of grain or something.
Walter might know. I think it does.
The actual Ukrainian.
I don't. It seems like it has a wheat.
I know it's gold and blue.
Wheat, yeah.
I don't remember.
I was thinking about that. So anyway, I don't want to get off on too much, but I just so from the standpoint of all this, I mean, it's not over. There's more, for our standpoint, there's probably more pieces to fall should this go the way that Putin would want in this. Right. What's our options? I mean, militarily, is there an option for...
Let me add this in there about the patriotism. I was there just 3 years after they gained their independence, and I remember I was talking to a gentleman through a translator, and he predicted, and this is in 94, 95, he said Russia's going to try to take Ukraine again. And we got into a discussion about that. He was an older gentleman. I mean, probably in his 60s, even back then. And
he looked older too. Right?
He looked older than me. Yes. And but he said he predicted they would try to take Ukraine again. And but he already within 3 years, you could tell. They already had that pride.
Yes.
And trust me, now the reason why I knew Donetsk is because that's where I was. Uh-huh. And he said, you know, all of them said, we will fight. Even in 94, 3 years after they gained their independence, they did not. And I keep hearing, you know, Putin was saying, old Donetsk and Crimea, yeah, wanted to fall back under Russia, wanted to come back. And I'm going to tell you, in 94, that was not the case. Yeah. They wanted nothing to do with Russia. And talking about their own language, I don't know if all, but most of the Ukrainians can speak Russian.
Yeah.
I don't know if all, but I mean, probably a very, very like 95 and up percent can speak Russian. But they also speak Ukrainian. They have their own language. And they really pride themselves on speaking Ukrainian when they get a chance.
Both of you know about this, and help me understand if I'm right about this, but some of the reports I have seen suggest that the family ties between Russia and Ukraine are, I mean, lots of families are stretched out across this border, and there is a border on a map, but families are in both places. So are we actually in a situation where we have family fighting against family?
I don't think so.
Okay.
I don't think so. I think the families, family members in Russia are the ones that are protesting the war in
about
Ukraine.
About what's going on.
17% of the Ukrainian population is Russian.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. That
definitely Russian ties.
Yeah. Good deal. Okay. Excellent. So why are we at this point today and Ukraine is not a NATO member?
We're scared of Russia.
That's exactly right.
Okay.
Yeah. You were talking about what's the consequence if
NATO comes in.
If Putin keeps going. And it's the same thing. If he, you know, at this point, and this is just personal opinion, not basing this on any experience except for what I see on TV and kind of my military experience, but no intel. If even if he, like, for instance, if he tried to go into a NATO country, and we try to stop him, where will it end? I mean, at this point, if Putin is if he's driven enough to attack a NATO country and say, I'm bringing them back into the fold, then I'm afraid he has nothing to lose. It's the same thing with Ukraine now. If he does not win Ukraine right now, Russian leaders lead by power.
Sure.
It's not, you know, in like the United States military, we always trained our successors to know what we know so that they could take our place if they needed to. When I was in Russia, they did not do that. Secrets were their means of power.
Well, information is power.
And I would say if Putin, just my feelings, if Putin does not win the Ukraine, then he'll be out of power.
Dennis,
somebody will force him out.
To that point, if I think about this, symbolically, it's going to be a huge loss for him internally, and it may open up a coup. Potentially,
absolutely.
I mean,
look.
Is that a long shot, or is that a very?
No,
likely?
I don't think it's a long shot at all. There are resistance forces in every force, in the world. There's someone that doesn't like the direction that things are going, and it's someone that has some power. Sometimes they're crazy people, and they become a terrorist in that organization, if you will, causing problems within the unit. But like Scott was saying, they don't build their leaders from within. They don't, you know, we were taught you're not a great leader unless you going away makes no difference. Mm-hmm. When you go on vacation, if you come back and there's turmoil, you're not a good leader. That's the way it's supposed to work. So there's always going to be someone that wants to take you out when you're in a system that doesn't bring up their own. So the guy that's under him wants to take him out so he can become the guy.
Yeah.
He wants to become the boss. So it's going to happen. And Russia, you know, they took a big beating and loss of a lot of world power when they lost total control of the Black Sea and the Baltic Sea.
Sure.
Okay. I mean, we've been doing freedom of navigation exercises there, since the 50s probably. Where we go in, you know, nations claim farther than they're allowed. You know, it's really 12 and 20, 12 miles on sea, 20 miles in the air that they claim as their airspace, mm-hmm. right? And water space, if you will, or land space. You know, you get close to that and they have everything light up to send you packing if they can. They light up all their SAMs. You're getting tracked by radar. They launch fighters. They do all sorts of stuff going, get away, right? We do the same thing. The Soviets have and Russia has continually sent Bear H bombers, Tu-95 Bear H bombers, carrying rotary launchers with air launch cruise missiles on their nuclear missiles that go against our coast all the time. It's a constant thing. Not constant. It's not daily, but it's at least a monthly event. They go against northern Alaska. They go against the west coast. They go against the east coast. And we light up everything we've got and make sure they're pushed away. We have sensors that can tell what they're doing and things like that. You know, and it's because we want to keep them as far away as we can. Well, they're trying to do the same thing. And the loss of control of the Black Sea, the loss of control of the Baltic Sea, you know, the Bering Sea, they're still pretty much in control there. But when they lost that, their naval power sort of disintegrated from those flanks.
Yeah. You know, I reminded at the end of the movie Stalin, when Khrushchev had actually just taken over, and he's now, and they're all in a balcony over watching a play, and there he is. He's ascended to the throne, if you will, and then right behind him, just a place behind him, is Brezhnev. And so then it's kind of reminded me that there's always somebody in the wings waiting. And I guess you could arguably say the beginning of his end was a Cuban Missile Crisis. And so if Putin gets to the point that he realizes what's at stake as far as if he looks weak, I mean, if he pushes too far, NATO's response will be automatic. It will not be it will happen. Will it not? Is there a chance, is there a safeguard that we don't respond in accordance with the NATO treaties?
Leadership is something that is hard to tell what will happen
Sure. Until
it's tested. Do I have a lot of confidence that that our current president will involve us in something like that if NATO is if a NATO country is attacked? No, I don't have that confidence. My fear is because I don't have that confidence, Russia also doesn't have that confidence. Okay. And they might go. And if we don't respond, the rest of Western Europe is lost. And if the rest of the Western Europe is lost, we're an island. We have trouble.
Yeah. So we talk about NATO, and we talk about how that component of it. So if we're left with sanctions, what you've already kind of alluded to the sanctions. I mean, gas, other metal, iron, steel, things that we know are now coming out of, not necessarily Russia, but some of the products that do come out of Russia that we put sanctions in place, you know, are going to inhibit them coming here, and in kind, them putting sanctions back. It really is a kind of a global economy begins to fall apart, does it not, Dave?
So there's parts of a conflict that would probably help the economy because that would stimulate production and growth, and as we build things to support whatever effort, then that would increase demand in some industries and take up for the lack of products. What we necessarily import from Russia isn't, I guess, the biggest concern. It's still that global economy. And so whatever we're losing out of Russia or Ukraine, or if Germany's no longer getting petroleum products from Russia, then who are they getting their energy from?
Sure.
And the when we talk about oil, we're really talking about energy. Right? And as gas prices, oil prices increase, then transportation, everything is going up and down roads.
That's right.
And so as gas prices go up, everything in Walmart is going to go up. Okay. So, and that's ultimately inflation. But as the U.S. dollar inflates, so does the world dollar, because this conflict isn't just affecting us, it's affecting the world. And as the U.S. economy goes, generally, so does the world economy.
Okay.
So even though it's hurting us and we're in for higher prices, the exchange rates, it's going to affect everybody.
And people are frustrated. Well, what can I do about this? I'm just a victim. We saw what Richard Childress did this week. I mean, I don't know. I'll open the floor up to each of you to say, what do you think? I mean,
applauding. Do you know what he said?
I don't know what he said.
Oh, did you not?
No, I missed that.
I'm sorry. Well, you know a lot, but you missed something.
I did. You're going to have to educate me.
Go ahead.
She says she doesn't follow baseball.
He donated a million rounds of ammunition
to
Ukraine.
Wow.
And you know, I think that's great. I think a million rounds. You were talking about all the equipment and things that are being donated to Ukraine. The problem is you got to have men to use them, and the war, this conflict between Russia and Ukraine is going to be determined by attrition. I hate to say that. You know, even though the Russian troops haven't shown that they're the best in the world. You know, we expected a lot more out of them.
Yeah.
There's conscripts. That's right. But there's so many of them.
Yeah.
You know, when you're outnumbered, I don't know what the numbers were, but it was 10 to 1 or more.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, you can throw a lot of stuff at them, and but these people that are coming from other countries, 16,000 isn't something to sneeze at, but at the same time, when they're going up against hundreds of thousands from Russia, you know, potentially hundreds of thousands, you know, I mean, the weapons are great, but if you don't have anybody using
them. What about the logistics of supporting the Russian military? From reports that I've read, they've got tanks and vehicles out of gas sitting on the road.
Right, and that's a case of they outran their supply line. Yep. They're trying to move so fast that they outran it. I saw videos of Ukrainian farmers pulling their tanks off and their personnel carriers off with tractors.
Zelensky said if they owned that, then they would not be taxed for their property.
Right. That's right. Well, yeah.
And just like in Iraq, okay, you know, Saddam Hussein outran his supply lines, and his people were surrendering because they were starving. They had no fuel. They had nothing. They were sick. That's you know, starving an army is the way you stop an army. Well, there's a way we can starve the Russian army, okay? There's a slide that Greg can put up that I'm going to address here. The Russians spend about 4.5 to 5% of their gross domestic product on defense, okay? But what drives them more is oil prices. If you look back historically, back to Afghanistan, each time that they've had a spike where they go over $100 a barrel, they go invade somewhere. They go take significant action against someone because they're emboldened with dollars. They have lots of rubles, if you will, that they can go do things. Well, so how do we stop it? We make it to where their barrels are cheaper. We cause that to happen. How do we do it? We open the floodgates. We open up just an announcement of reopening of the Keystone Pipeline. Mm-hmm. That's not going to get any gas anywhere, you know, for a couple of years at least, several years, I think. But that would have an impact. And we have reserves in place that if those reserves are opened up, it'll cause their prices to plummet. And then financially, they start taking a hit, and then their supply lines are harmed even more. Okay? When we harm their supply lines, their people are starving. The Ukrainians are going to be. You see the Ukrainians being nice to the Russian soldiers. They know that they're conscripts that are forced into service, and so they're being nice to them. Hey, you want me to help tow you back to Russia? You know, if we impact their supply lines, they run out of supply line. They've outrun it, and they'll go back home.
And the Ukrainians are prepared for attrition, I think, or are prepared. They've sent their women and kids away. I mean, almost a million have headed west and toward Poland. I think the Ukrainian people, and Zelensky's even come across, said, I'm not leaving. I'm staying here to fight. But I think the people are prepared for this type of, I mean, I guess you never prepare till you're in it.
That was a point I was going to address, too. Even if Putin does overrun Ukraine and take over and win the conflict or whatever you want to say, it's never going to be won. These people are never going to stop. So, and then when he goes into these other, if he goes into these other countries, the conflicts in every one of those countries, because they've had that taste of freedom for 30 years plus now, the rest of our days, that will be a conflict.
But and to back to our original point, it has been a place of conflict for a long, long,
forever.
Long, long time.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
It's not to I guess to Scott's point on that, it's not gonna be over.
Go back to the breakup of the Soviet Union. I think the Ukraine became like the third largest nuclear arsenal.
That's right.
And of course, Russia was trying to think, now how do I deal with that? And you know, because we're not in charge of that anymore. Yeah. And they've always thought about how am I going to get that back? And being the breadbasket in the food winter, because that's not something you grow in Siberia. You know, and then the Crimea being such a spot. I mean, there's so many things that Putin is just not willing to give up in that area. And it has been a center of conflict.
And you say they sent a lot of the women and children away, but a lot of the women and children, Scott said, you got to have manpower. But I've seen
a lot of
some,
women
I've
have
seen,
stayed.
I have really seen a lot of graphics, I mean, images, graphic images of women in the fight. Is it their beauty queen, their Miss Ukraine?
Yeah,
is.
Miss
I mean,
Ukraine.
She's, I mean,
sure.
she's, I mean, I'm, sure. I was like, wow, there it is.
Yeah.
I mean, that's, yeah, that's, to give that speech
that was
on the
recruiting poster.
Yeah. Let's talk a little bit about. Let's talk to the Ukrainian president. I want to do that, but I guess I want to go back. One other thing I'd bring out is what is China a factor in this? Is China having? Because I keep hearing that there's at least they allude to the fact of what would China do if would China come to Russia's aid with? I mean, if this escalated,
they're going to go gobble up Asia while we're busy.
They're watching. they're watching intensely.
If it gets us really busy, okay, then Taiwan is hanging out there farther than they have been ever. Yeah, right. You know, they've been actually creating islands to try to extend their reach to begin with. And I didn't do much. In other words, I did Soviet strategic aviation and Soviet civil navigation analysis, things like that, for the most part, until I went to headquarters and did, you know, general analysis. But so I didn't deal that much with China, but they were always in partnership. And so there'll be something happening over here, and the Chinese are going, hey, look here. They're busy. We're going to go mess with this. And Taiwan, they've been doing overflights of Taiwan, things like that. They've been wanting to reclaim Taiwan for
since 1970s.
Right.
So there's a lot. It really is. I mean, when you start pulling at the tapestry of the world stage, I mean, things begin to unravel in different areas, and that's why this one conflict is not this one conflict. It's a much bigger world stage.
But, you know, we can't forget we have allies in the Pacific. So, Japan is a big ally, you know, and they're right there on the doorstep. So if China does start getting moving toward there, I mean, we can't forget we do have those allies. When I first joined the Army in, 1987?
A little after I joined.
Yeah, just a little after.
I'm the old guy in the group,
that's right,
by the way.
The Army, the U.S. Army, not all the military services, but just the Army had 1 million people. Mm-hmm. In the United States, we had 1 million-man army. In the early 90s, we had a big drawdown, and we went to somewhere around 500,000, half of that. And a big worry, even back then, and for the remainder of my service, all the way up till 2014, one of the big talks was, we will be capable of fighting on two fronts. Meaning if we had to go to the European front and the Pacific front, we should be able to do that. So I'm not privy to all the upper information, but I do think we have superior equipment, and that would help us. But you got to think, could we do that, you know, if China did start something?
We have capabilities.
Yeah. We do.
We have capabilities that people in the regular service now, that are serving now, don't know of, okay? And I'm going to give you an example, okay?
Don't go to jail over this.
Not going to go to jail. Not going to go to jail. I'm going to give you two quick examples. Okay, have you ever heard of the SR-71 Blackbird?
Sure.
Okay, it flies at a classified speed. Can't even tell you how fast it actually flies, right? It was flying missions in the early 60s. But wasn't known to the public until like 1973, okay? The F-117, stealth fighter, okay? That's not really a fighter, it's a bomber. It has no air-to-air capability. I don't know why. That's a strategic arms limitations talk thing.
They play those games.
That's it. You know, what you call something has something to do with it. I've never understood. But there were missions being flown well before they were revealed during Desert Shield, Desert Storm. Okay, I know because I briefed their pilots when they were doing things, right? And so the first that they were exposed, I was able to take my wife, my son, and my father-in-law out to where he could see the F-117s when they were first revealed, right? And they have been flying missions for a long time, okay? So, you know, the UFOs you hear about and stuff like that, yeah, maybe it's just aircraft that we're testing and doing special things with. And we have capabilities along computer methods as well, okay? A lot of the battles are changed based on how you can interdict communications, maybe change their communications. Oh, we're over here. Nope, we're actually over here. But nope, we're over here, okay? And
I think our technology, since that time, we continue to advance, and I keep seeing report after report after report, like the Kursk that sank in the Black Sea, I think it was, but it, years ago, their equipment is continually degrading, and they're mm-hmm. not keeping up, and it's a drain on a weakened economy to keep up that military machine. So I think that's why we're in the spot we are. Well,
the reason the USSR disbanded was because Reagan spent more on bombs and military than sure. they could spend, and they would try to keep up. And as they did try to keep up, they spent themselves into bankruptcy.
Sure. Starved their people.
That was the primary concern. And then, as I refer to it in class, the MTV factor yeah. is that their young people started watching Western news feeds and TV. MTV,
sure.
and they saw how wonderful
how good
Blue Jeans, how wonderful it was in the U.S., and they said, something's not right here.
That's right.
And that helped drive the youth into sure. revolution.
Sure. Mm-hmm. As a leadership instructor, I travel around the country and I teach leadership at a variety of agencies far and wide. I'd like to talk about the leadership of a Ukrainian president because there's a lot of things, the snippets, the things I've seen of him, I love a lot of it. I always talk about walk the walk, talk the talk. Man, I see that in him, at least from my perspective, but I'll open the floor up. Anybody wants to say anything about
it? He is young, 44 years old.
That's what drives people to follow you to their death.
That's right.
A
general that I work for, I'm not going to use his name. Because I don't want anybody to be able to, or it'll be questions and so on. But a general that I worked for became very, very big in the United States architecture of war. Okay, during Desert Shield during Desert Storm, some things happened, and I had been working for him since he was a lieutenant colonel. But something happened, and I was exhausted. I was sleeping on a desk, and it was you were just working nonstop. And so something happened. They did something to one of our pilots that I lost it. I just sort of fell apart. I'll get choked up now. Oh. And he came in and asked what the heck was going on, because usually I'm a pretty tough character about stuff like that. And I just handed it to him, and he sat with me and cried. Mm. I'll follow that man anywhere.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I think that's the way the Ukrainians feel about. First, he was a TV star, and that always helps to get exposure. He was a Ukrainian president on his TV show, which is interesting.
Yeah.
But, I mean, he's so charismatic. So,
but he walks the walk.
He does.
Yeah.
I'm going to stay here and fight.
That's exactly right. They gave him an out. They said, get out of here. And he said, no, I am not leaving. And I'm.
I don't need a ride. I need guns. So, I need ammo. I need ammo.
A president that can speak eloquently, is. And I heard this term all during the Trump days. About acting like a president. I'd much rather somebody that can lead than act. And this guy, you wondered how he was going to work. And I mean, he's leading from the front.
I love him with a t-shirt on, out talking, doing his briefings. Right. I mean, he just seems like, man, I'm in the middle. I stopped long enough to come in here and talk to you people, but I'm going back out there as soon as this is over. And it speaks to me, and I assume it's doing the same thing, and he's motivating the Ukrainian people.
He's popularly elected. Their other officials are elected differently in single parliamentary lecture and then proportional, but that's the one person that is elected by the people of the Ukraine, and he is their commander-in-chief as president, and they must have a great deal of confidence in him.
Well, I hope he sets an example for the rest of the world.
I mean, I'm in awe of him just because of the way he carries himself, and I'm very impressed with him. So.
If the Russians make the mistake of killing him,
martyr.
He will be a martyr.
It will cause an uprising like they've never seen.
Sure.
Okay. When you have a leader that is that loved, people will say, okay, it's on. The people that were silent, that were being quiet, that would have been the mouse, are no longer the mouse. Think back to when JFK was killed. Okay. Our country went into deep mourning. Okay. I don't think that would have happened with any of our recent presidents. quite frankly, that there would be a total national, nonpartisan, deep mourning, okay? But for a country, while invading, to take out that guy?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. That's a mistake I wouldn't want to make as the guy running the war.
He superseded party lines. There's over 200 political parties there, and he supersedes that. Yeah. I mean, he has a political party, but that's not everyone. I mean,
Star, I've just got to ask, are you registered to vote in Ukraine? You know a lot about this.
I love political systems.
I find it
very interesting how different countries elect their leaders and run their government. Because you wouldn't call Ukraine a total democracy. Like we are, but it is certainly becoming a stronger democracy.
And I think
we're not a total democracy. We're still a republic, just barely, but we're still a republic.
That's great. I love the conversation. That's great. Now listen, here's the thing. As host, I can tell you this. In my world, my crystal ball is usually pretty cloudy, and I don't see very good into the future. But since y'all are guests, I'm gonna put you on the spot. What do you think that what's the outcome? How does this play out over the next? Whatever period of time, I'll let you tell me how you think it goes. Dennis?
Because of a leadership vacuum, in my opinion, I'm unsure of what's going to happen. If there is resolve in the White House and we continue the actions that are followed with the words, in other words, the words, we're going to support Iran, which I almost fell out of my chair when he had a slip of the tongue and called Ukraine Iran. But if we stand by them, not putting boots on the ground, doing all the supply, things like that, everything that that we should be doing, they're gonna run out of gas in Russia. They're gonna run. So we open up to where the gas is free flowing here. We drop the price down to where they're not making the money that they would be making. Okay, it kills their machine, and if we kill their economic machine, we kill their ability to fight, along with all the resolve that's around them, and it can happen to where they get minimized, and it doesn't happen again, at least for decades.
Sure. Good deal. Scott, what do you think? Along Dennis's lines, or something different?
A little bit different. I do think, I look at how their conscripts, their forces have performed. Recently, I saw an ad or a news program that was somehow they got a hold of a smartphone that one of the Russian soldiers had, and he had just texted his mom before he got killed, and he said, "We were told we were going to Crimea for exercises, and we are not doing exercises." And he talked about how they were targeting civilians and things like that. So I look at their forces, and I think they're already hurting. When their forces are writing stuff like that, you've already got a problem. Mm-hmm. But I hate to say it, but to me it doesn't look good for Ukraine.
Okay.
But I don't think it's going to end. I think this is going to be our lifetime. I think if I don't think we'll jump in it unless one of the European nations jump in it, and then we'll all be in it. So, but other than that, I don't think we'll get into it.
Our resident Russian expert, what do you think?
I was just going to mention France and Germany. Macron and Schultz are talking. They're trying to talk to Putin under the table, over the table.
Right.
I think that's where it's going to come down to. France and Germany have got to take control. They can't always say, "What you doing, U.S.? What you do?" They need to be powerful, especially Germany. They've always been a powerful country. Take control. Show Europe that they can't be dominated by Putin.
Okay.
So I'm anxious to see how they continue to respond.
Go ahead. From an economic standpoint, or wherever you want to say, just tell us.
I think the longer it drags on, the better chance that Ukraine's going to survive.
Okay.
So I think. The Russian military has already been stalled and has not made the progress that the world was expecting, and making assumptions that Putin was expecting it to go much easier. And so the longer that it drags on, the more resolve Ukraine's going to have. I am fearful that Ukraine will eventually, I'll say, lose control and Russia will have more access. The wild card in that question, I think, comes down to Putin. Okay, so desperate times call desperate measures, and if he is struggling with whatever health issues, whatever control power. I don't know that I, when we talk about leadership here in the U.S., I don't know that Putin wouldn't do things that would drag everybody into it.
A last-ditch effort to maintain his stranglehold on control.
I see Ukraine falling to Russia and it stopping for another 10 years. And over that time, Russia will rebuild, will get stronger again, depending on how the global economic sanctions policies factor in. I don't see Russia moving on immediately. I would be more concerned about China taking a look at how things went and moving towards Taiwan. It's their turn, but I see Russia, if Russia doesn't have Ukraine solid and they move on to somewhere else, then they're just spreading their force even thinner. And I am hoping to see more of a revolution within Russia. So that's kind of where I'm at.
Man, we've talked about so many different scenarios, different possible futures, and which one's real, we never know. But at least we, hopefully, Cleveland County, we've been able to make you think. That's the best thing we can do, is at least put ideas out there to let you consider and understand what's going on as best we know it today. We'll be eagerly watching this unfold over the next couple days, next couple weeks, maybe even longer. But until we get a resolution, it'd be interesting to watch how it all plays out. We've got several actors that we need to watch to see, and they're going to tell the tale, I believe. And Dennis makes me worry about other scenarios, and this going even farther. That's what he does for a living. Makes me worry. So
did for a living.
No, you did still make me worry, but that's another story. with that being said, Cleveland County, thank you for taking time out of your busy lives to come join us as we talk about this war in Europe and how it can come all the way across the Atlantic and come back here to Cleveland County and impact all of us. So we appreciate you joining us. Until next time, I'm Dave Allen. On behalf of our guests, thank you for joining us and being with us for this special effort, and we look forward to seeing you again.